Hello and welcome back to my channel. Last time I designed some LEGO train tracks and promised I would try to do a LEGO brick, and here I am trying to keep my promise. I really don't feel confident enough to try to do regular LEGOs, so I went with the LEGO Duplo for the moment, and let's see what we get. For this type of print, tolerances are crucial, so measuring accurately is very important. I will start with this simple square LEGO piece and start by drawing it on a piece of paper. Then I grab my calipers and start measuring as precisely as I can. I try to take multiple measurements in different areas for the same dimensions just so I'm sure it's accurate. The thickness is kind of a strange one because I always get errors, but in this case it's not really that important. The tight fit between the parts is ensured by the outside diameter of these cylinders and the 8 small ribs at the bottom of the part. It's actually really smart for LEGO to make them like this since they will be easy to adjust if there are any issues. After finishing measuring, I begin to model it. It's really straightforward. I just draw a square that I extrude up. I then fill in the top surface. I'm doing this in surfaces, by the way, just because it's the workflow I'm used to. Now for the most important features that will actually make the LEGO brick work. First, the cylinders on top, then the cylinders at the bottom. But before that, I decide to switch to part design and create the actual bodies. For the top cylinders, I create only one and mirrored it 2 times to get the complete set, also making sure I add the chamfer to make it slide in easily. The one at the bottom is supposed to press the top ones on the corresponding brick into the outer ribs, and it sits slightly higher than the bottom of the part to help with the guiding. Finally, we have the ribs, for which I use the same technique. I draw one corner and mirror it 2 times to get the whole set. While I do this, I'd like to take the time to remind you that it really helps out if you subscribe to my channel and leave a like to this video if you enjoy seeing this kind of content. Now that I got the hard part out of the way, it's time to smooth out the surface by adding a few radii, making sure we don't mess up any functional surfaces. Once I'm satisfied with the design, I import it in Cura. Since I don't want to spend a lot of time cleaning the inside of the cube, I choose the support structure type 3. Which should have minimal connection to the part itself. Unfortunately, when I try to slice, I get this little error, which is due to this very cool, actually, experimental feature that allows the support material to be broken into chunks by skipping a layer every X amount of lines. But once that's all sorted, I then generate the G-code, check it, and then I can start printing. It's just a 1-hour print, so it finishes quickly. I dropped the part on the ground and the support material fell out by itself, which is surprising since I always have difficulties removing it. And now to test it. I'm off to a pretty bad start. The top side doesn't grip at all, but it's not all bad as it doesn't look like the fit is too loose. On the other hand, the bottom side, it's a different story. It grips a little bit too well, which means the fit is too tight. If you are not familiar with the concept of fitting, I will try to briefly explain it in the next section. When manufacturing something in the real world, so not just in CAD, the dimensions will never be spot on. They will be within a range. We call that range tolerance. So, take for example these cylinders on the top of my part. They will have a nominal dimension of 9.35 mm, but the precision on my 3D printer is plus minus 0.1 mm, so the actual value can range between 9.25 and 9.45 mm. Add to this the other calibration issues, material flow issues, and slicing software settings, and that range can be greatly increased, which is exactly what happened here. Now, when you design a part that is supposed to go into another part, you need to account for both of the part tolerances, and depending on the overlap of the actual diameter range, we can have multiple types of fitting. First, we have a clearance fit, and that is when, in the worst case scenario, we still have a gap between the parts. If we have situations where from best to worst case scenario we can have either clearance or interference, we call that transition fit. And finally, if we only have interference, we call it interference fit. I'm not sure what the tolerances are for LEGOs and what kind of fit they have, but I believe we should have a very light interference fit, which with my 3D printed part, I do not have. So let's measure to see what went wrong. I start by measuring the cylinders, the distance between them, the rib height and the bottom cylinder, and notice that all of them are off by a considerable amount. The last one being the worst, with a difference of nearly 0.4 mm. So to fix this, I open up the CATIA model and change the dimension to compensate. Then I print another model. This one I did not drop and had to remove the support manually. Now fingers crossed for the next test. This time around, my brick works wonderfully. It kind of still feels a little bit different from the original bricks. The force required to connect and disconnect is really close, but not 100% the same. And it also feels a little bit different, more rigid, but this is PLA and it's not the most flexible material. So there you go. Now you saw how to make a Lego brick and learned a little bit about tolerances. Thank you for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. Have a nice day and see you next time.